Hello students, welcome back. I hope you are enjoying the entire series. In this upcoming series, we are going to learn about what exactly is website penetration testing. In short, we call it as website pen testing. We are going to start learning by how information is retrieved for a specific target. The entire process of hacking begins from the very first step, that is information gathering. So we are going to start off by capturing a lot of information about a particular target, and based upon those informations, how an attacker actually launches an attack on that victim. So we are going to start with the very first section, that is website pen testing, information gathering. After we have gathered a lot of information about a particular victim, we will shortlist our tools as an attacker, how an attacker performs an attack. We will think it from that point of view. We will shortlist our tools and toolkits, and then we will launch our attack specific to that particular vulnerability that we have found in the information gathering phase. So let me list down the various tools, the various topics that we are going to cover in this upcoming series. We are going to start with the very first tool, that is what we call as Whois lookup. A Whois domain lookup allows you to trace the ownership and tenure of a domain name. It is similar to how all the houses are registered with a governing authority. All the domain name registries maintain a record of information about how every domain name was purchased through them, along with who owns it and the date till which it has been purchased. Similarly, what does the Whois domain database contain? The Whois database contains details such as the registration date of the domain name, when it expires, ownership and contact information, name server information of the domain, registrar via whom the domain was purchased, etc., etc. Well, what is the Whois IP lookup then? We all know an IP is a unique address of a server on the internet. It is very much similar to how a telephone number allows you to connect to a specific phone on the telecom network. Similarly, IP addresses allow your computers to connect to a specific server on the internet. The domain names and IP numbers are the framework upon which the entire World Wide Web is built. Hence, the Whois IP lookup will allow us to find the IP addresses assigned to a particular domain, using which a lot of information can be gathered on that particular domain name. Well, how do we conduct a Whois search? It's very simple. We are going to do it practically, but for theoretical point of view, a Whois search is very simple. You simply need to enter the domain or IP address for which you would like to conduct a Whois lookup in the search box. And the Whois website will fetch the details and show it to you on your screen. It's very simple. So let us begin with our very first one, that is what we call as Whois lookup. So let's see what Whois lookup is. As explained in the theory part, Whois lookup is basically used to gather information about a particular domain or a particular server. So for example, let's take google.com as an example. So if you want to get information, if you want to gather a lot of data about when google.com domain was bought, what is its expiry date, till which date is google.com domain is available, when can it be bought, etc., etc. Obviously, whenever a domain is about to expire, an email is sent out claiming that so-and-so is the last date for your domain expiry and you should buy your domain before that particular date, or else that particular domain will be again put up in the public domain where others can even buy that particular domain. Obviously, Google being such a giant, Google will not want anyone else to buy google.com domain, right? Because it has its brand value, it has its image. So obviously, attackers or even hackers will be on the prowl of buying google.com domain whenever and wherever it is available publicly. So they will always keep a tab on what is the last date for this particular domain to expire, and they will try to buy it before Google. Obviously, it doesn't happen in real life because people are hired to do this task specifically and they are getting paid for buying and selling of domains of which Google actually holds. So this is not going to happen. Even Google has their own automated services nowadays using which they keep on renewing their domains whenever it is about to expire. You might have seen few examples where google.com or google.co.in domain or even Facebook domain was temporarily assigned to an individual either because of some bug or because of some hack. But they actually reclaimed the domain because Google doesn't want to lose its domain, right? So this is just an example of what Whois can do. So let me show you what exactly Whois is and how it works. You simply need to type in Whois and check whether it is there in your machine or not. Yes, it comes pre-bundled with Kali. So as you can see, this is the command Whois. And these are the various options or these are the various flags. You don't need to do anything, although there are multiple options given over here, but we will stick to the default, that is Whois and followed by the domain or that particular website. In our case, I will simply type Whois space google.co.in, for example. It will search google.co.in and whatever information it can capture for that particular domain, it will provide all those domains to me. As you can see, it has already completed the process. It has completed the activity and I have got a lot of information from it. As you can see, domain name is google.co.in. Registry domain ID is this. The registrar URL who actually had registered Google domain is this particular organization. It was updated on 27th May 2020. And its creation date, that is the very first time this particular domain was sold to google.co.in, it was 23rd June 2003. And the registry expires on 23rd June 2021. So this is the all important date, as you can see. As I was talking about that, on this particular date, google.com domain is going to expire. On this particular date, google.co.in domain is going to expire. And obviously, Google also has information about this and they will buy this domain well in advance. So as you can see, it's also having a lot of other information, that is a domain status. Let's see, let's scroll down what other details we can find out. Over here, registrant name, fine. The state, the province, the postal code. At some point of time, what happens is you have the option of paying some more amount of money and protecting your privacy. So what happens is if you opt for that, a very limited amount of information of yours will be available in the public domain. So small websites or small organizations don't go for that, but obviously big organizations and companies who want to protect their privacy, they pay some more amount of money and protect their Whois information. So all those information which are sensitive, for example the address, postal code, phone number, etc., will not be provided in the public domain and they will be hidden, they will be protected. So that's why we are not able to see these information. Otherwise, a lot of more other information which is obviously which can be made public can be fetched out by Whois. Fine, let's scroll down. As you can see, all this information is hidden, but we can see the name servers also. That is also one of those crucial aspects of Whois. It also prompts you the addresses or the names of that name server which Google actually uses, right? So these are the name servers of google.co.in domain, that is ns1.google.com till ns4.google.com. If I scroll down a little bit, you will see the description of what this entire operation is all about, what Whois actually is trying to find out, and what are the various documentations, what are the various legalities that you should be knowing before using this particular command. So this is how I can make use of the Whois command or Whois tool in Kali Linux. Well, there are different other ways by which we can make use of Whois. In Windows also, we can make use of Whois. It's very simple. If you simply go to your browser and type in Whois, press enter, you will see a lot of websites which actually provide you Whois search. So I will select the second website, that is whois.com. It is one of the most popular websites when it comes to Whois searching, right? Whois database searching. If I enter google.co.in over here, you will not be able to get the results from the Whois database. This will only tell you whether a particular website is whether a particular domain is available for sale or not. So let me type in google.co.in and search for it. Obviously, this won't be available because google.co.in domain is already being assigned to Google. So those domains or subdomains will not be available, as you can see. As you can see, it is google.co.in is unavailable. That's all what we know, right? Now, if I want to find out some Google Whois information about it, what I can do is I can either click Whois over here, or I can go to the particular tab on top, Whois, and then I can click on google.co.in and press search. So as you can see, I got the same registrar name in the case of Kali Linux also. If I go over here, and if you see Mark Monitor Inc, it's the same organization which had issued google.co.in domain, registered on 2003, correct, expires on 23rd June 2021, again correct, updated on 2020, all these informations are correct. Name servers ns1 to ns4.google.com, state, country US, and that's it. You won't get the email addresses because they are kept private. And I guess this was the entire information which was shown in the case of Kali also. This is the exact same information which was shown in the case of Kali also. So this is how you can make use of the Whois lookup, either in Windows or in Kali Linux. So as you can see, we can make use of the Whois lookup not only in the Kali Linux machine, but we can do the same task with the help of a browser and using the publicly available websites. For example, whois.com. The results are exactly identical, and you will get the same amount of data whether you are using a terminal in the Kali machine or a browser, either in case of Windows or any other machine with access to the internet. So this is how Whois lookup is very much useful when you are wanting to gather a lot of information about the name servers, the registrar who registered that particular website or the domain, when the domain is going to expire, what was the date when the domain was bought, and so on. So this way we can gather a lot of information using the Whois tool. So let's understand next how to make use of NS lookup. Next tool that we are going to learn is what we call as NS lookup. Now, what is NS lookup? NS lookup or name server lookup is a network administration command line tool which is used for querying the domain name system to obtain the domain name or IP address mapping or other DNS records. It is basically a command line tool, but we also have few GUI based tools. We will look into that whenever we'll see our practicals. In the previous video, we saw how we can gather a lot of information such as the domain name, the registry domain, the registrar's information, who actually issued that particular domain, when was this domain purchased, and what is the expiry date of that particular domain using this tool, what is we call as Whois lookup. Now we are going to make use of another tool, that is what we call as NS lookup. So Whois is not a command which is inbuilt in the Windows system, but NS is a command which is available in the Windows system. So it's very simple. You simply need to go to your Windows machine and open your command prompt. Inside your command prompt, you will simply need to type in NS lookup. Press enter. So we can see that NS lookup actually works. Obviously, we have not entered the additional data, additional requirements, additional options, that is why it is not working correctly, but we can say that NS lookup is a command which works in Windows. Whereas if I type in Whois, it will say that it is not existing, it is an unknown command. So you can simply say that NS lookup is a command available for Windows, but as we have not typed in the necessary options which should be entered along with NS lookup, that is why the request timed out. So what you need to do is you simply need to type in NS lookup. Let me clear the screen first. Now let's type NS lookup space, again our favorite website, google.co.in, and press enter. Now you can see that NS lookup or the name server lookup will first of all try to fetch out the name server for me, that is dns.google.com, its address and its actual IP address. So you can see 142.250.183.67 is nothing but the IPv4 address of the domain name server of Google. Similarly, this is the IPv6 version of the domain name server of Google. So basically, domain name server or name server is used to translate this google.co.in into a corresponding IP address. Obviously, this IP value will keep on changing depending upon from which location of Google's server it is fetching out and showing it to me, right? So if I run this command at some point of time later in time, I may get a different IP address. So it ultimately depends on which servers are replying back to my DNS query, right? So if I again fire this, at this point of time it is fetching the same result, but at some other point of time, if this result varies, then don't panic, because it ultimately depends upon which server is actually replying back to my DNS query. Isn't it cool, right? So this is how you can make use of this tool called NS lookup. But not only that, you can also work with this tool in an interactive mode, because what happened right now is what we call as a non-interactive mode. Why? Because you simply need to type in the NS lookup command and the website's name and you will get the answer. You are not interacting with the console, right? Whereas if you do something like this, NS lookup, press then enter, it moves into an interactive mode where it waits for you to enter something. So now let me type in facebook.com and let's see what is the result that is going to be fetched. As you can see, it is now waiting for me to enter the set of URLs, enter the set of websites, and it will keep on fetching the results and show it to me. And it will keep on fetching the results and it will keep on showing to me, right? So now I can look up for multiple domain name servers using a single command, that is NS lookup. So this is what we call as an interactive mode of NS lookup. Now let me type in my own website's name, for example, learnityourway.com. And if I press enter, let me see what is its DNS lookup value. As you can see, it is fetching out two IP addresses, one IP address over here, one IP address over here. So these are the web servers which are replying back to my domain, that is Learn It Your Way. Simple. So the interactive mode is very handy if you are willing to try out the DNS lookup for not only one website or one domain, but for multiple domains, right? So this is how we can make use of the NS lookup to find out the IP addresses of the name servers which are corresponding to a particular domain. In the next video, we are going to learn about a tool called Netcraft. So stay tuned.